I'm Craig ROSIE Rosevear, and welcome to How to TIC TOC and Rock. The very first reason drummers are in bands is to keep time. There's a number of ways to keep time. First importance is the practice of a metronome or click track. This way you'll have a reference point to how you're playing. Secondly is to count. When you're playing drums, you're playing songs. When you're playing songs, you're playing song structures. Now these usually happen in 8-bar phrases. For example, an introduction to a song will usually be 8 or 16. A verse will sometimes be 8 or 16. Chorus, etc. Guitar solo. These are all based on 8-bar segments. Now, it's our job as drummers to be able to bring the song in at the right time and to bring the next part of the song in with the right feeling. For example, a verse will be slightly subdued, whereas a chorus will jump out at you. A guitar solo will have a lot more going on to it than a verse. As drummers, it's very important to be able to count. What I usually do when I count is to substitute the number of a bar I'm up to as the first number of a count. For example, 1, 2, 3, 4. The second bar will be 2, 2, 3, 4. The third bar will be 3, 2, 3, 4. The fourth will be 4. All the way up to 8. 7, 2, 3, 4. 8, 2, 3, 4. And back to 1. In this way, I'll know exactly where I am within the song. For example, I'll count the song in. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now, from that very point there, you can start running into trouble. Because it's so important to be able to count the song in at the right time, at the right tempo or speed. Now, to be able to do this, what I usually do is run through the song in my head, maybe a chorus part from it, or something, some part of the song that I'm familiar with, and get the tempo from that. I'll establish the tempo in my head first, then count the band in. 1, 2, 3, 4. What I usually do is be counting and be thinking, what am I going to play in the part of a song I'm up to? For example, verses are usually a lot more subdued and there's usually a lot less going on musically than, say, a chorus. So usually what I'll do in the verse parts is keep a fairly simple pattern between the kick, snare, my hi-hat, and very important to have dynamics. Dynamics, the louds and soft in your music. It's so important to have those dynamics as a drummer, because as drummers, we have to start thinking like musicians. You've heard the joke so many times. What do you call a guy who hangs around with a bunch of musicians? A drummer. And unfortunately, in a lot of cases, that's true, because drummers aren't thinking in terms of songs. They're not thinking in terms of musical structures, etc., etc. And as soon as that starts to happen, you start being a great drummer and you start getting gigs. And that's what all the top guys are doing. They're not thinking just like a plotty drummer at the back, 1, 2. They're thinking music. They're thinking the song. Because that's why drummers are in bands, to play songs. If you want to just be a guy who sits in your bedroom and whittles around the kit and be the best soloist, well, go right ahead. But if you want to start playing in bands that play songs, that play gigs in front of big crowds, start thinking like a musician first, a drummer second. Now, a lot of drummers start to get in trouble as soon as they go to play a fill. They're cool, just playing along to the music, keeping time, okay, I've got that down, blah, blah, blah. When do I do a fill? What should I play in the fill? How do I come out of fill and still keep in time? This is all based on counting. Remember the counting. 1, 2, 3, 4. 2, 2, 3, 4. 3, 2, 3, 4. Etc. All the way up to 8. Okay, very important to play the fill in the 8th bar. So I'll be like 7, 2, 3, 4, 8, and 2, and 3, and 4, and bang. Now what this will usually do is serve as a musical full stop to that part of the song, and also a musical introduction to the next part of the song. So if we're playing 8 bars of verse moving into the chorus, what you want to be doing is counting in your head, getting to the 7th bar, filling the 8th bar, so when you go into the chorus, it explodes at the right time. Rhythm in my stride, I can't hide it. I got the blues on my mind. Get out my way, I'm coming through on my own. Yeah, yeah, get out my way, I'm coming through all alone. Can you tell how I've done that? The verse is nice and tight. Simple bass drum, kick and snare. Hi-hat's nice and tight. The chorus is dynamically exploded and really lifted up, because it's the chorus of songs. That's the big part that everyone sings along to. That's the big part of the song. Listen to the songs like Back in Black. I'm back in black. Big chorus. Big drums. Verse. Boom. Da-da-dum. Da-da-dum. Nice and simple. But chorus has got to jump out of you. So, as drummers, it's our responsibility to make that chorus jump out at the people out there listening. That's our job. The fills, I'll tell you now, if you ask the guitarist what did I just play in that fill, or the bass player, they're going to go, oh, I don't know. And I'll tell you why. They don't care what you play in the fill, as long as you get the fill in the right spot, play it at the right time, and come out of that fill correctly. And that's all based on counting. You'll go 7, 2, 3, 4, and then I don't care what you play as a fill, but make sure you're counting all the way through it. So at the end of it, 1, 2, you're back into the beat. 8 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2, 3, 4. Very important. Doesn't matter what rhythm you play, make sure you're counting all the way through it. That's the part where a lot of drummers get wrong. They're not counting. They're up there playing, oh, I'll just do a fill here because it feels right. But it doesn't work. If you start training yourself in your rehearsal room, put your click track on, start playing along to it, start counting 1, 2, 3, 4, 2, 2, 3, 4, 7, 2, 3, 4, 8, and 2, and 3, and 4, and 1, 2, 3, 4. It's very important to be able to do that. Another good use of dynamics within a song, specifically with fills, is the build-up. For example, between the four toms and the snare. A build-up is great to use at the beginning of a song, or when there's a stop in the song and there's a breakdown, to start it back in again. For example, AC/DC use it a lot. Etc, etc. It's a great way of being a musical drummer, using dynamics, and it's a great idea for a fill. Now, besides the timekeeping techniques of counting, practicing with a click track or metronome, etc., there are a few other things that you need to be able to do in your playing to be able to keep good, steady time. The very first thing I like to work on is the bass drum. Now, with the bass drum, I have to keep a good, solid beat using my heel up, my toe down, working the leg. This way, you'll get a good, solid bass drum sound. Nice and loud. Secondly, I like to make sure that every time I hit that snare drum, I'm hitting a rim shot. Now, what a rim shot is when the tip of a stick hits the skin, the shot of a stick hits the rim. Not this, but this. Every single time I hit the snare drum, that's what I play, a rim shot. That way you get a good, nice, solid thwack out of a drum. This way, the other people in your band on stage can lock in with the drums. It's very important for them to be able to lock in with the drums because they're playing the song with you. The drummer is the backbone. They're joining you. You're the guy. You've got to hold it down. You've got to keep the concentration. You've got to keep the beat. You've got to keep everything solid. Good bands have great drummers. Very important to remember that. Next thing I'll do is to play my hi-hat using the shoulder of the stick and the tip. Usually the way this works is on the one, with the shoulder on the edge, and the end on the tip on top of a cymbal. This way you get a nice hi-hat groove. Now if I start joining all these things together, you start to get a nice sounding groove. Hi-hat. Bass drum. Snare drum. Okay, other ways you can start improving your timekeeping techniques and playing for the song techniques is to use the hi-hat dynamically. For example, in the verses, keep it nice and tight closed. When you get to the chorus, just open that up a bit. Give it a bit of sizzle, a bit of swish. This way, the chorus will start sounding full, because the chorus is the part of the song that has to jump out at the crowd, has to jump out to the listener. And as drummers, it's our responsibility to think musically. Remember, we don't, as drummers, don't want to be the sort of the guy that just hangs around the musician. We want to be the musician. So we've got to start thinking musically. And part of thinking musically is thinking dynamically. So let's get the hi-hat in the chorus nice and loud and bring it back down for the verses. Have a listen. Verse. Chorus. Now have a listen to what it sounds like in a groove situation. Makes a difference to the song. Really makes that chorus jump out of you. It's very important to be able to do that. Another important aspect of being a song player and playing for the song is to be able to use the ride bell. Now, I tend to use the ride bell in the choruses of a song, usually on the downstrokes, the 1, 2, 3, 4, letting the ands being taken up by the tip of the stick. For example, the 1. The kick drum and snare drum, it sounds like this. I like to use the ride bell mainly in the choruses of the songs. This way you'll get a different effect than the open hi-hat. It's just a variation, but part of being a musical drummer is variation, being able to vary the parts you play. So, for example, within a song, I could play the verse on the hi-hat nice and tight, go to the open hi-hat effect for the chorus, and to get a little bit of variation, I might go to the ride bell for the guitar solo. All the time I'm doing this, I'm thinking in terms of keeping time, tick-tock, tick-tock, like a clock. As drummers, we almost have to have inbuilt clocks in our head to be able to keep time. I'm counting, and I'm thinking fills. Okay, I'm thinking what my fill idea is going to be, playing through the fill, keeping time within the fill. Very important. A lot of drummers get to the fill and just go crazy, and then the time's gone out the window. So all the good timekeeping concepts they've used up until this point are thrown out the window, because as soon as you get to the fill, you've lost it. And that's where a lot of drummers fall down. They play fills that are just all over the shop, the time goes out the window, and suddenly the groove's lost. So, within a song, I could go from verse, chorus, guitar solo, and we'll demonstrate that now. There is showed how to think musically, structurally within the song. For example, we'll count the song in. Now remember, when you count the song in, to establish the tempo firmly in your head first. Secondly, bass drum technique. Heel up, toe of your foot on the nice, firm, solid. rim shots on the snare. Very important to hit those rim shots on the snare. Get a loud thwack out of a drum. And hi-hat technique. Nice heavy downbeat. 1, 2, 3, 4. Lighten up on the ends up where you just get that real mechanical machine feel. And that just doesn't sound good. We don't want that mechanical machine feel. We want a nice groove. Now remember, choruses have to jump out. So let's go for a good strong beat in the chorus. A nice 4 on the 4 kick drum sounds good too. And remember, throughout your fills, count. Keep the band in time. That's why you're up there. Remember, timing, timing, timing. I'll say it again. It is so important in playing the drums. That's what we've got to think. That's what we concentrate on. I do in the Screaming Jets, there's like guys stage diving, people jumping off the rafters, crazy, it's mayhem. What you have to do, you have to think song first, that's the most important part. Get the song happening, count the song in. It's very important when you count the song in to make sure it's the right tempo. Establish the tempo in your head first, then count the song in, and then make sure everything runs smooth. Make sure you count the song in really loud so other people in the band can hear it. It's very, very important. You have to be able to do that. Then once the gig's playing, think the song, lock in with the bass player, lock in with the singer, think song, hit hard, keep time, timing, timing, timing. I say it all the time, but it's so important. Make sure, a lot of times the younger drummers, they get excited. The crowd's jumping, they're moshing out, there's chicks smiling at them in front row, they get so excited, and they speed up, and by the end of the song, the song's like a million miles an hour. Gotta keep your head down, keep concentrating, keep the groove going. Just zero in, concentrate, lock in. Lock it in, okay? And the thing is, as a drummer, whatever you do, don't stop. If a guitar player stuffs up, or you know, if a singer comes in at the wrong place, don't worry about it. Keep going, keep that song going. I don't care if the roof caves in, keep playing the song. That's the most important part. Just keep doing, keep that head down, and keep playing. It's very important. As a drummer, you're the backbone to the band, and you're the most relied upon person in that band. Don't be unreliable in a live gig situation. I've learned about playing double bass drum is that speed is not the first prerequisite. The most important aspect of playing double bass drums is to remain in time and to keep everything solid. A lot of guys will be playing a real nice groove, and as soon as they get into the double bass drum part, the whole thing falls out the window. The time goes out the window, their intensity on the bass drum, how hard they hit actually playing the bass drum, drops off when they go to do the double bass drum part. And in essence, you have like boom, ba, boom, ba, ba, and it just doesn't do it for me. And I'll tell you, listening out front as a member of the audience, you can really tell, because suddenly all the tightness of the band's overwhelmed by this bluga, 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 which is double bass drum playing. What I want to stress is for those who have got double bass drum pedals, is to first get the timing thing happening. Get that metronome set up. Practice along. Digga, digga. Make sure the right foot and the left foot are equal in volume. That's the first thing. It's so important to have that, because that will lead to making everything sound very solid. And remember, you want to have it nice and tight. Da 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 da. As opposed to digga, digga, digga. Because as soon as you go to do that sort of thing, the whole timing goes out the window. We play a song called Living in England. Now this starts off with a fairly fast double bass drum attack. The way I approach this song is to think timing and consistency and solidness of the double bass drums first. That's what I go for. The speed factor is something that will happen on its own. And when I practice, I tend to practice a lot, just playing at simple tempos, for example, around 120 beats per minute, just pounding away, keeping in time, for example. It's the consistency of play, the control you have over it, that really makes a difference to that. So I'll practice that for a long time, and then when I go to play Living in England, for example, then I'll go into the single bass drum, that'll be tied too. Timing. So important. Another thing I like to practice with my double bass drums is incorporating into semi-quaver IDs or 16th notes. It sounds like this. 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a 4E and a... Combinations of these between the snare drum and bass drum can sound great. For example, 1E and a, 2E and a. And then split the hands up around toms. Then I can add some extra toms. So from this pattern here, which is a nice Latin feel, play it on the snare drum. Filling the gaps with your tom. Incorporating the double bass drums. Tuning, very, very important aspect of playing. You're not going to sound good until your drums sound good. Now, there's a few different concepts as far as tuning goes. The very first thing is to get even tensioning on the head. For example, all your tension rods, which are these little groovy things here, have to be in tune with another. What I usually do is place my finger in the middle of the skin and just tap near each lug to make sure they sound in tune. Now, as you can tell, some of those are okay, some of those are out. So what I'll usually do is just have a bit of a blip around with the drum key to make sure all those are sounding in tune with one another. What I sometimes use as a reference point is the actual note of the drum itself. This will give me a bit of an idea of the note I'm aiming for. Another important aspect is the relative tension between the top and bottom heads. I like to tune my drums with the bottom head tighter than the top. So if I was to hit my bottom head, it's a lot tighter than my top head. The size of the drums is a big player in the way a drum kit will sound. In the kit I've got fairly small toms. This is a 10, 12, and 14. My kick drums are 22 by 18, and my snare drum is a 12 by 7 Dennis Chambers Signature Series. They're all Pearl drums. I think Pearl make great drums, and I've been playing for a few years. I use the pasty sound formula cymbals. I like the way they sound, and they're also fairly small. They're 16 inches. This way, when I mic my drums up, I can put mics on the cymbals as well. I'm not going to get too much spill or leakage into the other mics that are on stage. This way, they can really get a nice, cutty drum sound, which works great with the other instruments on stage, for example, the guitars, bass and vocals. This way, when I listen back to desk tapes, I can hear my drums come through clearly, and I really like the way they sound. Also, being a lot smaller, I can get a lot of punch out of these drums. The intervals, or separation of the notes between the drums, is also another important factor when tuning the drum kit. I like to be able to play in the mood on my kit. If I keep this tune in mind, it gives me a good basis to tune my toms from. Believe it or not, I've seen guys turn up for gigs with one set of sticks. I can't believe it. This is my stick bag. I've got everything in it. I've got brushes, extra sticks, spare bass drum beaters, pens, drum keys, you name it, everything goes in here. And I tell you what, I'd be totally lost without it, because once you're up there on stage playing the gig, you haven't got time to go out the back for a little search around for a pair of pliers, or hang on, I just got to get another set of sticks. You're up there, you've got a job to do, you've got to do it, and you've got to be prepared first. It's very important to be prepared for the gig. A lot of guys don't even check if everything's tight on their drums before they do the gig. You've got to make sure everything's in full working order, because I'll tell you what, there's no excuses when everything falls apart. The only one guy to blame is you, the drummer. Attitude. Attitude is such an important thing as a musician, as a drummer. You're in a band, you're playing with four or five other people, whatever. You're a link in the chain. A chain's only as strong as its weakest link. Communication is such an important factor. You could be travelling, in my band we travel in Tarago vans, sometimes up to 8 hours in the van a day, talking. Work your problems out. If you've got a problem on stage, you can't hear yourself, the guitar player's too loud, talk about it. Don't talk about it after the gig when everyone's emotions are running high. Have it in the normal light of day, have a bit of a chat, try to work things out, make sure that all that's covered, okay? Being in a band's like being in a family. Okay, communication is such an important thing. Okay, so a little bit of give and take on all people's sides and you'll have a successful unit. So, if you want to do the big gigs in the big cities, remember, attitude. Timing, timing, timing. I say it once, I said it 1,000 times, so important. Work on those timekeeping techniques. Get that kick drum happening, that hi-hat, count the song in right, etc. Fills, okay, remember, work your fills in with your grooves, very important. Double bass drum stuff. Well, get it so on, it's rocking, okay? Tuning, okay? Make sure your drums sound great. You got a good sound out front, that's what you're aiming for. The gig, remember, the gig's not your bedroom, it's not your practice room, it's a live situation. Remember, play for the gig. Practice, practice, practice. Every chance you get in there, get on the pads, get on that drum kit, bash away. And once again, attitude, attitude, attitude. I say it, but it's very important. Be able to be easy to work with, be a good vibe in your band, kick that band up the butt and get it rocking. Okay, so I tell you what, at the end of the day, have fun, keep time, and go off. Remember, that's how you TikTok in rock.